like flies. General Tukhachevsky, who was commissioned by Lenin's regime to massacre anti-Soviet elements in Tambov province, set up death camps where prisoners were gassed. And once again, the Nazi parallels are quite interesting. And civilian disarmament was a precursor to the genocidal rampage conducted by Tukhachevsky. On June 11th of 1921, General Tukhachevsky issued order number 171, which commanded troops under his authority, quote, to pronounce sentence on any village where arms are being hidden, and to arrest hostages and shoot them if the whereabouts of the arms are not revealed. Wherever arms are found, execute immediately the eldest son in the family. And within days, Tukhachevsky and his berserkers commenced a gas warfare assault upon those few armed residents of the village who had sought refuge in a nearby forest. It is my belief that the National Socialist regime in Germany built upon the Soviet example, and I think that the parallels that we have mentioned thus far are really quite instructive. The difference here is that the Nazis made use of an existing gun registration law that had been passed during the era of the Weimar Republic. And lists of registered gun owners compiled by the predecessor government made it quite easy for Hitler's totalitarian government to disarm its internal opposition, particularly Jews and others who were targeted for annihilation by that regime. There's an author and attorney by the name of Dr. Stephen Halbrook, who is one of the leading scholars on the subject of civilian disarmament. And he has said that gun registration laws inherited by the Nazis, quote, made it easy for a tyrannical government to confiscate firearms and make prey of its subjects, close quote. Now, to illustrate how this works, Halbrook refers to the notorious purge and pogrom known in history as Kristallnacht, the Night of Broken Glass. It was staged by the Nazis against the Jews of Germany in November of 1938. As Halbrook recounts the relevant developments, Kristallnacht, quote, was preceded by the confiscation of firearms from the Jewish victims. On November 8th of that year, the headline of a New York Times report from Berlin read, Berlin police head announces disarming of Jews. And the Times story reported as follows. After invading, Nazis used pre-war lists of gun owners to confiscate firearms, and many gun owners simply disappeared. Following confiscation, the Nazis were free to wreak their will upon the disarmed populace. Now, it's interesting for me to see how the New York Times in 1938 had no difficulty seeing the connection between gun registration and the emergence of a lethal, murderous totalitarian regime. That's a connection that they don't particularly seem to recognize in the year 2000. Now, shortly before the actual rampage began, the Times reported, quote, that Berlin police president Count Wolf Heinrich von Heldorf announced that as a result of a police activity in the last few weeks, the entire Jewish population in Berlin had been disarmed with the confiscation of 2,569 hand weapons, 1,702 firearms, and 200,000 rounds of ammunition. Any Jews still found in possession of weapons without valid licenses are threatened with the severest punishment, close quote. Now, on the day following the Night of Broken Glass, the New York Times offered the following dispatch from Berlin. Quote, one of the first legal measures issued was an order by Heinrich Himmler, commander of all German police, forbidding Jews to possess any weapons whatever, and imposing a penalty of 20 years confinement in a concentration camp upon every Jew found in possession of a weapon hereafter. Close quote. Thousands of Jews were arrested and dispatched to concentration camps under the jurisdiction of Himmler, who would become the chief architect of the extermination project now known in history as the Holocaust. Now, contemporary advocates of civilian disarmament are either ignorant of this historical lesson or are content to exploit the ignorance of their audience. One such figure who has skillfully exploited the ignorance of his audience, of course, is Bill Clinton, who said the following on ABC's Good Morning America program on June 4, 1999, in response to a question about gun registration. Quote, should people ought to have to register guns like they register their cars? Do I think that? Of course I do. Of course I do. Close quote. Now, for the Nazis, gun registration lists were used to brand gun owners as potential enemies of the state. Many of these enemies of the state were subsequently branded with concentration camp tattoos and eventually fed to the crematoria. Now, where registration lists are unavailable, gun grabbers seek other means to entice gun owners to surrender their weapons, as General Gage did in Boston in 1775. Such measures include gun buybacks, which are a transparently dishonest euphemism because it assumes that the government can buy back something it did not previously own. Beginning in late 1999, the Clinton regime, acting through the Department of Housing and Urban Development, or HUD, conducted a buyback initiative called Buy Back America, through which police and housing authorities could collect firearms at a going rate of about $50 a copy. The interesting thing about the buyback initiative that HUD was conducting is that it obviously creates a black market for handguns and other weapons. All that's necessary is that somebody would steal a weapon and turn in the weapon to the police and get $50 from the police in exchange for as many guns as he can collect. Obviously, law-abiding citizens have no incentive to turn in their weapons for $50. Obviously, criminals have no disincentive from going out and stealing those weapons so as to get $50 a copy for each one of them. The interesting thing about the Buy Back America program is that it was completely illegal. There was no money appropriated from Congress for the purposes of that initiative. And in June of 2000, Representative James Walsh, who oversees appropriations to HUD, informed the agency that the gun buyback program was an illegal expenditure and demanded that the department cease with the buyback program. And Bill Clinton, in the finest dictatorial tradition, simply dismissed this objection, saying that HUD has the authority to carry out this program because he willed it to be so. One of the reasons why it's important to take note of the so-called buyback initiative is that that is part of what's going on with the United Nations program for general and complete disarmament. General and complete disarmament is an expression that is familiar to people who have seen this document, Freedom from War, the United States Program for General and Complete Disarmament in the Peaceful World. This was a proposal which was made in 1961 by John F. Kennedy as a framework for the creation of a United Nations monopoly on military force worldwide. In the third stage of this three-stage program, the United Nations would enjoy a monopoly on strategic weaponry, meaning nuclear arms, as well as a functional monopoly on the military forces of its member states. But each member state would be permitted to have an internal security force, which would be a centralized, militarized police body that would carry out policies compatible with the United Nations vision of international law. As part of each internal security force's monopoly on power within the constituent states of the United Nations, you would have to have some form of civilian disarmament to bring about general and complete disarmament, except for those arms which are in the hands of authorities recognized by the UN. It's not well understood that the United Nations is conducting an effort at worldwide gun control or worldwide civilian disarmament. The UN Center for Disarmament Affairs, which is deeply involved in this initiative, which began to gather steam back in 1995, refers to buybacks of weapons as a practical method of micro-disarmament. There's that expression again. Micro-disarmament is the disarmament of civilians. Macro-disarmament would be the disarmament of nations. And the UN Center for Disarmament Affairs refers to such examples of micro-disarmament as those conducted by UN peacekeeping forces in Haiti, El Salvador, Nicaragua, and other countries. A 1995 paper by Dr. Edward J. Lawrence, who is a consultant to the United Nations Register of Conventional Arms, studied both buyback programs as practiced in many American cities and those conducted by the United States Army in Haiti. And in the latter example, once again, the United States Army was acting under UN authority. Dr. Lawrence says the government buybacks of small arms, quote, must be conducted in parallel with other efforts such as seizure programs. And the chief value of a gun buyback, according to Dr. Lawrence, is that a gun buyback program will focus attention on the links between weapons availability and crime. In other words, it's a way of persuading people that in the interest of peace and safety, the guns have to be under the monopoly control of the government. Sami Faltis of the Bonn International Center for Conversion, which is another think tank working with the United Nations, has made that point very explicitly. This is what Sami Faltis has to say about micro-disarmament. Quote, a subtle mix of rewards and penalties is needed for a weapons confiscation program to succeed. Ultimately, the ownership of arms should not be left to the personal choice of individuals. The state needs to preserve its monopoly of the legitimate use of force. So sanctions against the illegal possession and use of arms are necessary and should be imposed. However, during a weapons collection program, an amnesty is needed and the emphasis should be on voluntary compliance and positive incentives, close quote. One other very useful scrap of documentation regarding the United Nations objectives in the area of civilian disarmament is a report that was issued in February of 1998 entitled Rapid Progress in UN's Worldwide Effort to Harmonize Gun Control Laws. It was put together by a United Nations associated researcher by the name of Philip Alpers from New Zealand. This is a summary of the four United Nations Economic and Social Council Commission on Crime Prevention and Criminal Justice regional workshops on firearm regulation for the purposes of crime prevention and public safety. There's that word, safety, again, that were held in 1997 and 1998. This document quotes the United Nations as saying the following, quote, with the passing of the Cold War era and a shift from interstate military conflicts to insecurity resulting from violent crime, the United Nations has begun to turn its attention to a class of armament that is killing more people than major weapons, namely small civilian-owned firearms. To control light weapons internationally, it will be necessary to control them nationally. Once again, we can see the link between the United Nations concept of civilian disarmament and the idea of general complete disarmament in the peaceful world. In order for weapons to be controlled internationally, you have to have national gun control. This document also talks about the four workshops that were conducted by the United Nations Economic and Social Council, in which member nations were encouraged to regulate using such means as gun amnesties and/or gun buybacks to regulate the possession of arms by civilians. The consensus achieved at these workshops, according to this document, contained the following assertions. Quote, it is not a right to possess a firearm. This was the consensus. And there should be no free availability of firearms. To put the matter bluntly, the United Nations wants your guns. And it will use micro-disarmament measures, beginning with invitations, perhaps inducements such as the gun buyback method. It would include such measures as gun registration, and ultimately will involve confiscation. And that's the process that's being discussed at the United Nations right now. Once again, it's useful to hark back to the hideous memory of Nazi-dominated Europe to see how micro-disarmament works in practice. Think of just the following examples. Following the invasion of Holland, occupation troops deployed posters that were published in both German and Flemish that had the following notice. All firearms and ammunition, hand grenades, explosive devices, and other war materiel are to be surrendered. The delivery must take place within 24 hours at the nearest German garrison. Following the capitulation of France, the same posters were deployed. These, of course, were written in both French and German. At the time that this was going on and the Nazis were rampaging through Europe, disarming populations and inflicting their version of peace and safety upon those occupied countries, the Swiss Army issued a manual on armed resistance that underscored the foolishness of surrendering your weapons to the type of government that would demand such unilateral disarmament of its subjects. Quote, should you be so trusting and turn over your weapons, you will be put on a blacklist in spite of everything. The enemy will always need hostages or forced laborers later on, that is, work slaves, and will gladly make use of the blacklists. After the deadline, raids coupled with house searches and street checks will be conducted. Close quote. And it's appropriate that those observations were made in a Swiss Army survival manual that talked about armed resistance, because it will be remembered that Switzerland, which was a tiny landlocked nation surrounded by Axis-dominated nations, was the only nation in continental Europe that never made an arrangement, never made an accommodation with the Nazis. It remained free of the Nazis, it remained free of Axis domination, it remained unentangled from the hideous travesty and bloodshed that were World War II. In a large measure, that's because of the Swiss gun culture. It's not just a matter of geography, and it's not just a matter of having all the banks in Switzerland. Switzerland is a country in which every adult male is expected and required to have some proficiency in firearms. And everyone is expected to be part of their country's militia that will come to the aid of that country should it ever be invaded. On July 25th of 1940,